having these Dinner with the Doctors because it's really, let's turn down the music actually too maybe. It's a very, you know, small group, small setting. Feel free to ask any questions. I just ask that you ask the questions at the end. That's why you have the piece of paper there just to jot down things as I talk. I know your lap space is a little minimal. Do hold on to your plate because we have a second course. So instead of getting a second plate. So if you want to put on the ground while you jot notes, I'll go through everything that's on your notes there. But I really thank you very much for coming. And something called you here tonight, whether it was a Facebook ad or whether it was a wife or a friend. So I thank everybody who is an existing patient in the office and who brought someone or two people. I'm thankful for that encouragement. But there was just like there was something in whatever you read that said, hey, I want to learn more about what this lady is talking about and offering. So again, thank you very much for coming. So questions I get asked all the time are three questions. And those three questions are these. Doc, how do I get well and stay well? How do I get my family healthy? And how do I stay healthy? Second question I get asked often is how can I handle stress better? And we're going to talk about what stress does to the body and how the body would you say, just hands up, would you say the body works well under stress or not well under stress?
Not well.
We're going to kind of dive into what that means. And the third question I get is how do I live a vital life? Vital. So I thought, well, what a better way to really open up today with, you're going to get answers to all those questions in the next 19 minutes or so. So really the goals of tonight are really simple, is to get people, I want to get people excited about the possibility and potential for their health. Perhaps we're suffering from a health challenge now. Perhaps we're in a spiral of testing and it's just that we don't know how to get out. Maybe we're just searching to be the best us that we can be, maybe for a variety of reasons, right? I want you to get you excited about your health. The second is I'm going to make it really simple and easy. I like to keep it simple. The concepts that I'm going to share are very, very not complex. And the third is action steps. So saying, hey, what could the next step be to get healthy, stay healthy, handle stress better, and really live that vital life? And I chose to title this, how it's going to go, so I'm going to talk for about 20 minutes. We're going to get up, we'll eat some more. If you have any questions, like I said, save them to the end or just corner me over here if it's a personal question. If you're comfortable, you can ask it in a group. But the word vital is really key. That's why I titled this Vitality 101. When people come to the office, I ask them two questions. I ask them many more than two questions, but one of the questions is, how healthy do you think you are? Thinking about all of the facets of that person's life, be that positive health strategy, nutrition, diet, exercise, mental wellness, all of the facets that put the wellness puzzle together. And I can get anywhere from, man, I feel great, I'm healthy, I'm a 7, an 8, it's out of 10. I say, where are you, where do you want to be? Then I ask another question, how vital do you feel every day? And I get a very different answer. To me, vitality, and the word vitalness means how bright is your bulb to the world? You know, how do you have energy to spare? Do you get up every day excited? Do you have vim, vigor, vitality? Do you have, you know, you're enthusiastic, you're happy with your place in the world, your light is shining? And do you know that I get a very different answer when I ask people, how vital do you feel every day? If people said, I'm a 7 or an 8 and I'm happy there, I said, how about, well, I can have a 2 or a 3. There's a big difference there, right? So I want to get people excited about how we can live a vital life. So that's, as we start, I am a chiropractor, and it is our, I'm probably going to share with you concepts, and maybe you want to turn it down just a touch. I can tell, but it's a lot of bodies. I'm probably going to share some information about how the body works and about chiropractic that might be foreign to you. Many people think they understand what chiropractic is, and I'm going to share some insights with you. I mean, my full belief and understanding is that the body is designed to be well and healthy. That's what the human body's designed for. It's not designed for illness or sickness. It's designed, and we help patients express and experience life to the fullest. And we look within. So basic neurology, again, not gonna make you a chiropractor, but it's important we understand. And if you have a free hand, I know we're eating and drinking, and on the trifold there with the lady on the front, the little pamphlet is what I'm trying to say. The little pamphlet gives you, if you open it up, gives you a nerve chart. And basically, all of the power that runs the body comes from our hard drive, right? Our master computer up here in the brain sends all the power, all that life-giving force down the spinal cord. And out. It comes out like a Christmas tree. And it goes through, believe it or not, 45 miles of nerves. There is 45 miles of nerves in your body, in your body, in your body, in your body. And the speed at which the transmission of information is 270 miles per hour. So it's really fast, and there's a lot of them. But this is the command center up here in the brain. And it communicates what we call, it's not just chiropractors, it's called innate intelligence. The body is very smart, right? It is three things. It is self-running, self-regulating, and self-healing. And self-running means this. Our body continues, you're eating your delicious, dinner today, and we're not thinking, okay, I need my pancreas to do this right now, I need my gallbladder to do this. It just does it, right? We don't have to think about it. You do not have to plug yourself in at the night and charge up the body, right? Interesting fact, your heart beats 100,800 times a day, and it will continue to do that, right? So it's that self-running piece. Self-regulating is that people know what the word homeostasis is, or balance, right? There's a balance point, and the body knows exactly. There's thousands of chemicals and hormones. There's a balance point for everything. If something goes too high, the body does its darndest to bring it back. If something goes too low, the body brings it up, right? If anybody has, for example, sugar in the ginger ale or sugar in your coffee, your sugar then gets into your blood, can't stay there. Body has to take the sugar out of the blood and put it somewhere, right? So it's always in that state of regulation. So it's self-running, it's self-regulating, and it's self-healing. I mean, if anybody ever cut themselves, what a silly question. We've all cut ourselves, right? Depending on the size of the cut, well, here's what happens when you cut yourself. Say you cut yourself, immediately the body goes to work. That smartness is in action. There's inflammatory products that help heal that cell, white blood cells. It scabs over in about 2 weeks. You don't know that you had a cut there anymore. That's on the outside, right? But on the inside, that happens all the time. 3 to 5 million cells in your body die every minute and are reborn and are reorganized and are reorganized. So we sat here maybe 5 minutes, you do the math. That's a lot of cells that have died and have reborn. So it's that reorganization until the day that we die that happens. And we don't, gain and lose a lot of weight moment by moment, right? But that flux of cells, that timed, cell death, if you will, and reborn. We always want our cells, the next generation, to be healthier than the ones before. And that all of that self-running, self-regulating, self-healing comes from the nervous system. Okay. So basically, command center, this is the hardware. We have the bones of the spine. Literally, your brain goes down your back. People get freaked out when I walk around with some, like, y'all have one. Your brain goes down the center of your back. This is the hardware, all of the hard bones. They're there to protect that which is important, which is the software, which is the brain, down to feed all the parts, just like the Christmas tree. All right. It's like an Oreo cookie. Everybody likes Oreo cookies in moderation, okay? Right, yes. Okay, so the job of the nervous system, think of it like the middle man in the Oreo. It's the white part. Its job is to process life. So life is the top part, and life comes at us. Life comes at us at a speed of about 2,000 bits of information in a second. Would you say sometimes life overloads us? Yes. So the word stress, I told you we're going to talk about that. That's what really life is coming through the top layer. We have many different kinds of stress. Basically, there are three kinds. Physical stress. That's your falls, your jars, your bumps, twists, falls. Our posture is a big one, right? Many people, I don't have a job where I sit a lot because I'm standing. But if I did, a lot of people, 35 hours a week for 35 years, we sit, right? As soon as we sit, we change the positioning of the hardware. As soon as we put our head down, we change the position of the hardware. And if you remember nothing else but tonight besides my name and the great food you had, remember this, the way all of those bones, and we've got, like I said, 24 of them, I was gonna say 29 and I'm wrong, 24 of them, the way the spine sits and moves feeds the brain. So if the spine is not sitting in the right way or moving in the right way, the brain is not being fed that proper information. We have a fancy name called proprioceptors, just motion sensors in the back that tell the brain what to do. 80% of them are in your neck. So if the brain, if the body is not moving, the brain is not being stimulated and can't process life properly. So, like all of that stuff, physical, emotional is your, I say my five F's. Finances, fears, family, frustrations, or failures. That's our emotional stress in our life. You can think cumulative, you can think one time. And chemical would be anything in our food, in our air, in our water, habits we have, pills we take, just things that come to us, through us, or around us. The more that do that, the less well our body works. Think of it like this is the middleman. It has to process all of life. So as a chiropractor, I'm not, honest to Pete, not concerned. I'm not concerned with fixing bad backs. I'm more concerned with getting the processor up to snuff to the best of its ability to deal with life. So the strength of that processor stuff comes at us. Let's say that this is life, right? This is the top black part of the cookie. Our processor is that middleman. It's the adapt. How can we adapt? Adapt means change, right? Is it able to do that or is it struggling? And the bottom is ease. So the nervous system takes all of that stuff. And remember we talked about that balance bit, so that's the bottom of the cookie. Think about stress. I mean, we just talked about the iPad, and people, everybody probably has one in their purse, if not two devices. But statistics tell us we check our phone 150 times a day. 150 times a day. If you don't think that head goes forward, shoulders roll in, the blue light of your phone actually stimulates your brain to be awake, and we're going to talk about what stress does to the brain. But if, going with the iPad theme, just these are types of stress to get you thinking. Some people say, well, I'm not under stress. Well, let's think about that a little bit. We have our posture, maybe diet, injuries, our sugar, work, deadline, schedule, anxiety, accidents, finances, thoughts, toxins, trauma. So just think, if you have an iPhone or an Android, I mean, I have an iPhone, but it can get overloaded, right? And you have to close down all your apps to reboot the computer. So I think this is a good analogy, because sometimes we get overloaded, right? There's just a ceiling that the body says, I'm overloaded here, and I need to shut down. Many people, when they're under stress, different things happen, but they may have to have a rest or get out of that environment, just to kind of shut down and reboot all those apps running at once, right? There is that ceiling, that level that we can only handle. Talking about posture, question for you. Do you feel better? And it's a small group, or it's a, it, I love the